In 1993, Nine Inch Nail guitarist and collaborator Richard Patrick departs the band for his own new project, fter. In 1995, they released the debut Short Bus, which launches the band on the national scene with the iconic track, Hey Man, Nice Shot. Since then, the band has put out solid releases, including the chart-making Take a Picture. Richard is back in 2023 with a new fter lineup and a release entitled The Algorithm. Richard took a few moments in his studio to talk about the longevity of the band, the upcoming release and tour, and more. This is a 99 WNRR and Launchpad Live interview with Richard Patrick from fter.
Hey, this is Richard Patrick from fter, and you're listening to 99 WNRR.
Hey everybody, this is Artifacts from the Launchpad Live and 99 WNRR, and this is an absolute pleasure and an honor for me to introduce to you from fter, Mr. Richard Patrick, to the program. Richard, how you doing, man?
How are you, sir? Can you hear me?
Yeah, loud and clear. How are you?
I'm fantastic. Maybe I'll turn my phone this way so I can join you in being horizontal.
How you feeling, man?
I'm fantastic. I'm doing good.
Single's great. I'm excited for the new record.
Thank you.
I have a question. First question would be, have you thought about paring it down? I know you were thinking about paring the name down. Are you going to run with it?
I'm going to go with the amalgam or the a new title, which escapes me right now, but it's called The Algorithm.
All right, cool.
Because the old title was just so long.
It was. I know you were struggling with it. I had watched a bunch of conversations prior about that.
I think it's just better if I say I like the algorithm better. I think it's cooler.
Yeah, I think so. I think so.
It kind of because this record reminds me of the Amalgamut. And it's kind of like a little bit of a return to the Amalgamut, a little bit. It's so bombastic. There's so many bangers on this record. And the algorithm, just it's a little bit more a part of the times. I'm still bitching, but I'm not as outwardly bitching. I'm not taking sides as much on this record. I'm bitching and I'm talking about liars and cheaters and thieves and it's just that I'm not literally calling everybody out like I did on the other two songs that I had that came out last year.
You're talking about America and
America. That was supposed to be on a whole record called America, but I decided those two songs just kind of live on their own, and they kind of reference each other. And then when I started working on this new collection of songs, I just figured it was a whole new record. So
I was curious about what events were obviously affecting your thought process and the creation of not only those two, but, you know, on this one going forward.
What's that?
Well, obviously, the Murica and Thoughts of Prayer is obviously, like you said, tied themselves together, and there's a certain message in there. And
yeah,
I think it's pretty obvious what you're speaking to. Has that thought process led into the creativity of this new record?
Yeah, I'm still complaining politically, but I'm just not so outward. Like, you know what I mean? It's there's another thing. A friend of mine is drowning from alcoholism. And I talk about him in a couple of the songs, a song called The Drowning. And, but most of it is just me kind of reflecting on humanity and just kind of saying, like, are you checking yourself on this? Are you watching how we're behaving? You know, because we are, I mean, our government and the way we're behaving as a, it's like just the bitchiest, juvenile shit I've ever seen. Like it's just ridiculous.
That part and parcel because of now the you know, the channels and the avenues people can now voice their opinion, where obviously a lot of times they couldn't. And is it the case that maybe this is the way people really were, or do you think that they were just, we think they're egged on by all of this information and that you can post at any point in time?
Social media is mental diarrhea.
Absolutely.
And the amount of disinformation, the amount of misinformation that is spewing from one side is astounding. And there are people that believe that Donald Trump is still the president and that he's in charge of the military, and Biden, like, there are people that are literally believe all this QAnon shit. And the other side wants to give you health care. That's about as crazy as they're at. They want to give you health care. The other side thinks that there are lasers pointed at the earth to start forest fires owned by Jews.
I know, I've read some of this. It's insane.
And the other side wants to curb pollution.
It's pretty cut and dry when we get it down to it, as far as
like one side wants to curb pollution and the other side says you're trying to take my gas stove, and like is on Fox News, and they're saying, you know, and one side is like, hey, could we try and chill out on pollution? Like it's so night and day that it's astounding. And it's kind of, you know, so it's easy to write about. Like, lyrics just fly, man.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
there is no writer's block from this department, from my department as a lead singer in today's, especially when like Joe Strummer is dead. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah.
Like fucking Joe would be going off on this shit.
The thought of that is just chills. He, forget it. He'd be losing it.
But thank God we still have Al Jorgensen.
Yeah, we do. Thank God.
Al's still pumping out new music every day.
Hey, I'm talking from actually the home office. So being from Cleveland, that doesn't bother you back there. What is it?
Oh, the Steelers? None at all.
All right.
I love the Steelers. Like when we would inevitably blow it, we would always root for the Steelers, you know, because you're still part of the Midwest, you know.
Yeah, true. Good
people. No, I love Pittsburgh. I love Pittsburgh.
Yeah, that town is, well, I mean, it's come a long way too. It's been it's beautiful right now. I mean, it's and the people are awesome. It's just so family oriented. It's great. It's a great place to be. And a growing media capital right now. Their media spending is through the roof. So they're really, really growing. That's good. And the rock scene is actually really good too.
We had kind of a failed show there. We got to go back and really play for real. Get back to Pittsburgh and play one show for real. I just remember the time in Nine Inch Nails when we had played Pittsburgh and they closed the venue down and made it and turned it into a disco. So we played at like 9 o'clock and then they essentially kicked us out and turned it into a disco.
Yeah.
And Trent and I got so drunk at the disco after the show that we started like banging our bottles together and breaking them. Like, you know how you do that thing where you bang the top of it and it.
Yeah.
Spooks up. If you do it just the right way, you can blow the bottom out.
Yeah, that's true. That's happening.
And so we kept trying to do that with all these beers because people were just giving us beers. Like, I got to buy you a beer.
Oh, that's too good.
And we ended up, and we ended up, the bouncer was like, I know you just played, but you got to go, and literally threw us out of the front door on our asses. And we were just laying on the cement, laughing our asses off. Like, just like, can you believe this? We had this huge, amazing, incredible, great concert where everyone was jumping around. And here we are lying on the concrete out the front, you know, basically shit-faced and just 25 years old, laughing our asses off. Just like, we knew we were killing it. We knew we were taking over the world.
Yeah.
You know, to what degree, we weren't sure, but we knew that we were on the upswing and things were looking good. Yeah. And getting kicked out of clubs, you know, was just amazing.
Before, you had mentioned, you were talking about songs on the record, and I want to talk about, because there's so much about this new album I want to get into. But you had mentioned just briefly that you wrote about songs about a friend that has, that, you know, battling alcoholism. And by the way, congrats on
20 years.
Congrats, man.
Thank you.
That's freaking awesome.
Yeah.
How do you, I mean, obviously as a creative, you put it into words and you put it into song. How does it feel as just to sit there and know, cause you've been there, you know, how does it feel to sit there and watch somebody do this?
And I kind of picked it up from my parents that it's really hard to watch and, you know, hard to experience. And I put them through hell. And to sit there and watch my friend, who's literally the nicest guy in the world, he's just drunk all the time. And he has destroyed his life. He has completely destroyed his life. He used to have so much stuff going on.
Yeah.
And it's just brutal. And so you're trying to throw him a lifeline and he's just drowning. He's just drowning in a sea of alcohol. And I can't wait for people to hear the record, because there's all sorts of great moments like that on the record where, you know, I'm just being truthful, you know.
What is it about? I mean, the generation that you guys, you know, kind of came up all together and all the bands for the first time. I mean, I think other bands in other decades, but for the first time, your generation of songwriters and singers and bands were able to tap into the human condition at a time that I don't think I can remember that anybody was. How were you guys able to do that? You guys,
I think we,
truth, I, to everybody.
I think we were really turned off by a lot of the stuff that was going on in the 80s, except for like U2. U2, like, you know,
yeah,
they had a record that was dedicated to Martin Luther King. And the single came out and there was a picture of Martin Luther King on it. And it was Pride in the Name of Love. And like, my God, like, just standing for something, just completely, just totally, like, this is what we believe in. We're wearing it on our sleeves of our the jackets on our records. And I just remember thinking to myself, that is the way to go. Being totally and, you know, utterly just truthful and honest. And saying something, and Joe Strummer, same thing. And I think that because that was the ethic in punk, and that punk ethic was there with grunge and with Ministry and Skinny Puppy. And Skinny Puppy stood for animal rights.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were very heavily, you know, opinionated about animal rights, and rightfully so. You know, the way we treat creatures on this planet is terrible. And I just loved that. I loved how people were just saying what they felt, you know, and all those guys, Cornell, Cobain, you know, Vedder, Trent, they just wore it on their sleeves. Even like Phil from Pantera. Like,
yeah.
He had that, you know, he had that that song Broken, where he's talking about his own problems. And thrash metal, it wasn't about like, you know, your problems. It was about like, you know, other stuff. And even Phil like opened up about like how hard it is to go through, you know, back pain and, you know, injuries and stuff. And that's why I had the song Broken. I'm broken.
Yeah.
But there was just something in the air that I think I don't know if people want to hear this or not, but I think Bono had some, he was an influence on everyone that was coming up during the 80s in the underground, you know. And then, and look at Radiohead, you know, it was just very important to be real. And I think that that's why it's such a great period of music. Because, you know, we were real. I mean, you know, we let it happen. You know, we were honest.
Yeah, and then all the unpretentiousness went out of music, which is, you know, let's face it, you know, what we had to deal with in the 80s, especially in the late 80s. Early 80s I can take, you know, early 80s is all right. You got the early days of Priest, early days of Maiden, you got the metal, yeah. You know. And you know, somehow that lost its way, because that was really, you know, people were latched on to that. Metal was the underground back then.
Yeah.
And the bands back then had something to say. And then they, you know, like anything, they got caught up in the money and they lost their way, you know.
Yeah.
And in the mid 80s. But
yeah,
when you talk about U2, is that where you get your just propensity for writing like killer melody lines? Within all this heaviness that you drive so much,
melody is the first and last frontier of music. You know, being in the key and singing melodically is a challenge. You know, like my brother asked me one time, why do you rhyme words? You know, you don't have to rhyme. The Boss kind of proved that. Bruce Springsteen said you don't have to, you know, he doesn't rhyme every word. And I'm just like, because the challenge of doing that excites me, you know, and rhyming. And there's just a certain way I learned how to sing. And melody is like, it really stems from the Beatles. It stems from Bono. It stems from the Rolling Stones. A lot of the Rolling Stones was a huge influence in my melodic sense. But yeah, I'm one of those singers that like, I would love to scream everything and like, and just be, and have this white noise scream. I'm in a band with this kid named Jim Laveau. I got a new band I'm working on called A Place to Kill. And, he has this insane white noise scream. It's like, it's just the most amazing thing. And I can't do that. So like, I'm left with melody. Like I'm stuck with melody and like, and just kind of melodically getting my way out of the day of songwriting. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Like at the end of the day, I have to write a great song. Like, you know, it's, and so I'm kind of stuck with this voice that is a melodic scream, and I have to write those melodies to kind of pay the bills. You know what I mean? But a lot of that comes from just Mick Jagger and John Lennon and Paul McCartney and Bono. 'Cause I was young enough that Bono was a huge influence. You know what I mean? Yeah. I was young enough that when they were huge in 84, that's when I was like, you know, 13. And that was an impressionable part of my life.
About the same. I was about 15 about that time when that was going
on. How old are you? Are you 54?
55.
Damn, you look good.
56 coming up.
Dude, you look good.
Thanks, bro.
I'm gray as shit, bro.
Oh, come on.
I'm letting it hang out. I'm a gray fucking man. Like, dude, I'm letting it hang out.
I got the promo shots. I was like, dude, that looks boss. This is great. Looks good.
I am a gray-haired man, and I'm okay with it. And I would hope that everyone else is okay with it too, because there's no other way to live. You know what I mean?
Well, they got this whole thing. Even like the women are like letting it grow.
Yeah.
Yeah, like all over the place. Like no more dye for me.
It's I mean, they're throwing away boxes of dye. I noticed Perry Farrell let himself go gray. I was like, there you go. Like, he let himself go gray. You know what I mean? I'm like, there you go. And there's other, Dave Grohl is getting flack for going gray. Like, he's letting it go gray. And I say we do it. I say we let's get old, honestly.
Oh, man.
Let's honestly just get old. Who cares?
You know, I saw this. I thought this was really, really cool. And very poignant. It's obviously with this new record, you did and played, I believe, everything on it, correct?
I did, except for three or four songs. I did co-write with a guy named Zach Monowitz,
mm-hmm.
who's a genius, 22-year-old little kid I found on Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
He makes these insane guitar parts, and he's from the generation. And he wrote three songs with me. And then I wrote a song with Sam Tenez,
mm-hmm.
Mark Jackson, and Ian Scott, or Scott Ian. I think his name is backwards. It's not the guy from Anthrax, but okay. Super genius song called Obliteration, which is going to probably be our next single. And we're going to go to radio with it, because For the Beaten wasn't really a radio track. It was just kind of like, here's us back from, you know, from the last couple of years, you know, taking a year off. And then Obliteration is something we want to like literally send it to radio and like see what happens.
Have you ever met him yet? Have you met him yet? I know that was a while back. You were talking about him. Moskowitz, that's his last name?
No, I still haven't met
him.
Zach Monowitz in the flesh. I've never met him in the flesh.
Wow.
We've collaborated. We've written. Everything is through Dropbox. And he is an amazing, and one of his best friends is now working here at my studio with me for movie scores and stuff like that. His name is Chris Brocata. And so him and I get together every day, but Zach Monowitz and I have not met. So Zach Monowitz did three songs with us. And then the rest, believe it or not, is me, is 100% me, just with my computer and my guitars and basses and a lot of bass synth. And yeah, just letting it rip, just going for it.
I saw and there was one interview that was I was checking out, and
I also, just real quick, I worked with Brian Liesegang on two songs.
Okay.
Brian wrote a lot of lyrics for me. He co-wrote some lyrics with me. He is an amazing lyricist, Brian Liesegang. Mm-hmm. So he's a blast from the past that worked on the record too.
Well, that was that whole thing that happened between 2018 and 2019, where you're doing, you were kind of, you know, working together again, and then all of a sudden, you know, doing the Pledge Music thing and the whole rebus and all that stuff that went on, and then, you know, they go bankrupt, and so, and
took
then
it with it. Yeah, that took it with it. It killed the vibe. You know, I had to kind of reevaluate, you know, what was happening with Filter. Since then, I've gotten new management, and Brian just moved on. He lives in London now, and he's got a lot of stuff that he does. But yeah, for a moment there, we were going to do this record called Merca or Rebus. Or something like that.
Yeah.
And we did five songs together, and two of them we put out, and then two of them are going to be on this new record. and they're gorgeous. I mean, you know, they're just crazy. Like, it's really weird, but you know Army of Anyone?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Okay, so Army of Anyone, I was planning on releasing a song with them. So I kind of wrote an Army of Anyone song, but for some reason I just couldn't get in touch with Robert and Dean on that level on working on Army of Anyone again. So I just had Ray Luzier play drums on it, mm-hmm. and then I played all the guitar and bass with Johnny Radke. And there's a song called Summer Child that's co-written, me and Brian Liesegang co-wrote it, but Ray Luzier plays drums on it, and it sounds exactly like an Army of Anyone song. So there's some hope for Army of Anyone fans that there's a song that's brand new that sounds exactly like Army of Anyone, but it's just not. I just couldn't get the DeLeos to work on it. For some reason, our schedules didn't work out.
Yeah, and that the Army of Anyone stuff, that's like, I know that people have asked you if that was ever going to get back together again. That ship has probably sailed along.
Yeah, I just don't see it happening anytime soon.
No, now I'm actually going. Oh, yeah. I've interviewed Lacey a couple of times. How did you guys meet?
That was a management thing.
Really?
Their managers worked with Flyleaf. I went to go see Flyleaf, and it was they blew me away. They did a cover of Something I Can Never Have by Nine Inch Nails, which I thought was amazing. And she had worked on some other songs from their record, just blew my mind. And I let the managers told Lacey that Richard Patrick from fter is a huge fan. And she went, oh my God, I would do anything to work with them or do something. And so I said, let's do a cover of U2. Because I'm a huge U2 fan, let's do a cover of Pride in the Name of Love. And you sing the verses and I'll sing the super high choruses and, you know, and we'll freak everybody out. And she said, great. But then she started singing the harmonies with me, which were amazing. And it just was a record company thing. It was a management thing. It was like, let's do something for the, you know, for the soundtrack, the Family Value soundtrack that came out that year. And we ended up doing it. And it was amazing. I was blown away.
Pretty stoked that they
are back together. Yeah.
They're back together. Yeah. Yeah.
And we're playing some festivals together. I don't know if we're playing on the same day, but we're playing some festivals with them. So it'll be cool if we could cross paths.
Yeah, I know that. I think they're going to be out here. There's one called Bamboozle in Atlantic City, close to about 30 minutes south from where I am right now. So yeah, that was cool. And when I talked to her, because she was putting out State of Me and she was working with the Skillet Gang. And there was no inkling. It was just, you know, her and Josh doing her thing. And that was a shock. When I saw the post, I was like, whoa, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. And they're awesome. And she's amazing.
Yeah,
she's amazing. Yeah. She was funny. She was like, Before I go on stage, I just pray I don't do warm-ups. And I'm like, you're gonna need to do a little warm-ups too. And she's like, I learned how to do warm-ups, Rich, because I was telling her, you got to do your warm-ups, because she's got a scream. She's got that amazing scream, you know?
Yeah. Well,
and that's taxing on your voice, you know?
I'm a student of Don Lawrence out in New York City, who's pretty much worked with everybody. So an hour, get to bed early, and an hour. I don't know how people do it when they're partying all night and still able to keep their voice and go through a tour. And I'm impressed, because I was in bed at 11:30 after the show, and then back up again and doing warm-ups. I don't know how people
do it. Crazy. Yeah. Well, the warm-ups are a lot. You know what I mean? You got to learn how to do your warm-ups quick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't want to be singing for an hour and a half before you go on stage to sing for an hour and a half. You know what I mean? You want to do them in like 20 minutes, you know?
When are you guys jetting out for the tour, and how long do you expect to be on the road?
So shit is starting to hit the fan in May. Oh, and by the way, the For the Beaten is going to come out on a 7-inch. It's going to be available on vinyl. And on the back side of that 7-inch is my new band that I've got with this kid named Jim Laveau. It's called A Place to Kill. So the 7-inch will have For the Beaten on it, and then you flip it over and it's going to have this new band that I've got. And we're trying to introduce this band that I have, this other thing that I've got out there called A Place to Kill.
That's a very cool way of doing it.
Yeah.
I've never seen that, especially to get it out there. That's an awesome way to do it.
Yeah.
The creation of the band Short Bus really came in the beginning of, the digital age and how we share music. I wanted to get your thoughts. It's a question that I ask, a lot of guys who've been, been in from since the 80s and through the 90s and everything like that.
Yeah,
exactly. I mean, really, I don't know if there's an answer as to how we can get back.
To what?
To somehow before it, where music is is hold up to some value instead of shared like a cheap piece of, anything, because there's so much.
Well, streaming has really helped. All of that sound exchange, all of that stuff has really helped. We have to be grateful that, like, we're at a place where we are now where at least the hemorrhaging is over. Because during what I call the death of music, between like 2006 to like two or three years ago, there was just rampant pirating. I mean, it was just pirating. And thank goodness it has kind of come back to a place where at least you're getting paid for something. You know what I mean? But it is a far fucking cry from where it was back in the 90s when people would go in and buy records. You know, they would buy CDs.
Oh, yeah. I know.
And it sucks because the songs that come out and are displayed as singles will get heard by a lot of your fans. But when you release a record with 14 songs on it, half of those songs, I don't think people ever really make it to. Because people, it's hard to go on Spotify and say, play this song by this record, by this band, play this album by this band. Mm-hmm. It's hard for people to kind of wrap their heads around an album because it's such a single driven world. That I kind of am bummed out that, like, it's not an album world. You know what I mean? It's even though records come out and they're on albums, like, it's a super fan that goes, okay, I just got that, like the last record called Crazy Eyes. Yeah. I love this last song was amazing. I really like when I get, and it's very few people. Like, you know what I mean? And the singles off of Crazy Eyes weren't my favorite songs, but they were like the songs that the label thought had the best chance of being a single. And I'm like, damn, man, if you're not writing, you know what I mean? Like everything perfectly for that one song, you mm-hmm. know, then everything else is going to get dissed, you know? And so it's a weird new world. And I just hope that when people buy the new record, the algorithm, I hope they give it, play it through like the way I wrote it. Like it's to be listened to in one big sitting, for 45 minutes,
Yeah. I mean, the whole thought of the album, we both come from an age of album oriented rock. Mm-hmm. We're listening to three Zeppelin, 2, 3, and 4 and one and everything yeah. that came out and Floyd and all that stuff. And, if I still thank God for people, well, first of all, people thinking in the realms like you do of creating a full canvas, so to speak,
yeah,
as an album, When you get artists that are just thinking about, and we see it now, even with some of the hard bands, that, you know, it's the same program beat. It's the same, yeah. You're all doing the same chuck. But when you're thinking in the broad spectrum of an entire record and that kind of creativity, we're getting that musically, at least. Like, I don't like half the songs that are on that I love that are that's on anthems. Live. Yeah. I love the deep cuts on that record. I really do.
Thank you.
Sun Comes Too is another big record for me. I mean, obviously, Short Bus is one of the sexiest records I've ever heard. But I call it sexy. That album is just sexy. Yeah. It is a sexy
cool.
record.
Cool, but I'm glad.
For me, Anthems and the Sun, those are two big albums for me. Listening to say we're then. Go ahead.
You are gonna fucking love this new record because I didn't go for like, okay, this sounds like it could be on radio. I didn't care about it. I literally wrote it for 100% like what I want out of music in 2023. And that's when you're writing for yourself and not for anyone else. That's literally when an artist is at their best. Because the fans that love Title of Record and Short Bus and Amalgamate, we were literally fucking crazed lunatics that would literally write just for what made us happy. And especially myself, you know, I remember being in almost fist fights with Gino over songs that he wrote. And I was like, dude, I don't hear it. Yeah, it's got a beat and it's got chord progression and blah, 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 blah. I don't hear it. And he would get furious with me. You know what I mean? And then I would write Welcome to the Fold in like the morning. Like I told those guys to go to, when I wrote Welcome to the Fold, I told those guys to go to lunch and I put all of the Marshall cabinets in a semicircle. We had six stacks between like the two guitar players.
Mm.
And I put them in a semicircle, detuned it to AADGBE, and played Welcome to the Fold. Literally just sat there and pooped it out in one fucking 15-minute period. When they came back from lunch, I'm like, check this shit out. Played it Welcome to the Fold as loud as I could in this semicircle of Marshall stacks. And literally they were like, you got to record it. So we went and recorded it that night. And then by the end of the, like, and then we added drums to it later. And that's literally the first song off of the, of Title of Record. It was written in like literally 10 minutes, you know? And I just had so much fun. Like we got to this middle part and it was like 17 minutes long when we originally did it because I was on mushrooms. And I was going, mama, give me my medicine, you know, mama, give me my medicine, you know, like for like literally 15 or 20 minutes, mama, give me, you know, just this weird shit, which, you know, I wouldn't do today. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think there was a record company on planet Earth that would sign someone that's sitting there doing mushrooms while they record their vocals. You know what I mean? But that's what made it amazing is the fact that we were doing crazy shit like that and it was working. You know what I mean? It works. That song fucking, we cut the middle part down quite a bit, but that song works. You know what I mean? And people love that part, you know?
Yeah.
And that's what this last record, this, and I'm not just tooting my own horn. This record that I'm just am finishing up right now, I just got a new mix of a song. Yeah, I you can't hear. We'll get a link going and I'll put everything up on a SoundCloud and I have a private link to it when the record's done. It's the shit, dude. It is such a good record. It is such a, and it's the main reason is because I've actually joined, I've grabbed the technology again and I just bought a huge computer and so much of it is done by me now.
Yeah.
Like that, it kind of cuts out the middleman kind of thing. And like, it gets me closer to the music.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the shit so much. This record's almost done. There's only like three songs left to mix.
There was actually, I just had like a couple, I had a couple more questions for you.
Sure.
And one of which is there any parallel that you can derive from the excitement of this record, and there's so many different things that you're doing, and a lot of the stuff that you're doing yourself, and the excitement as you did with the first record?
Yeah, the first record was a similar thing to me because so much of it was done by myself. I mean, there are parts of Short Bus that were done with me and an 8-track machine and like my little sampler.
Mm-hmm.
And the first 5 songs on the record were that was how I recorded. Except when I did Hey Man, Nice Shot, Trent let me record it at his house because he was in a generous mood back then. And I demoed Hey Man, Nice Shot at his house. And, you know, he literally like, see you later. There's my studio. I'll leave you alone. And so the parallel is because I'm really, really like I'm producing it and I'm writing most of it.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's not that I didn't do that. You know, with like The Sun Comes Out Tonight, so much of that was Bob Marlette. Mm-hmm. And Bob Marlette's a super genius, and I really appreciated working with him. But this one is a little bit more like the quirkiness of Short Bus, the weird things about Short Bus are parallel to what I'm doing now, which is just some of the things I do. Some of the things I do just musically break the law. Like I'm going against keys, and I'll sing in a different key than the music's in, and like I'm breaking rules left and right when I'm left to my own devices. And there's something kind of cool about that. Those quirky moments.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I got a lot. The first person I think that opened that door for me, believe it or not, that out of left field, some of the stuff I couldn't believe was actually Tori Amos.
Mm-hmm.
I thought Little Earthquake was just like, holy shit, is she breaking?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that really went out on a limb. So,
yeah.
Yeah. So I know what you're talking about.
Just like, you know, like people are going like, Rich, you're singing in between notes. I'm like, what does that mean? It sounds good to me. And they're like, Rich, you're not in, you're like in between key, you're in between notes, like you're C sharp, you know? And I'm like, well, is that bad? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know what keys, I mean, I do and I don't, you know what I mean? Like, I want to make records that really blow me away, as opposed to like where I was trying to blow a record company away, you know? And I can't say that I won't tell you which filter records I was trying to like make it a record company happy, but there have been a few. And this record is like, there's nothing to lose. I mean, it is literally like I'm doing this all from my own personal studio, and it took me 4 years. And you know, there's no time limit on it. There's no time restraints. I don't have a budget. It's just me rocking out.
There's so many artists, though, I think that when they get into that tug and pull with, you know, trying to please a certain amount of people, that they wind up losing themselves. And for some,
exactly,
who said they, you know, and they wind up losing the core of who they were.
Yeah.
You know, forget about just the music. They wind up losing themselves.
I can tell that on this record, this new record, that like literally so much of it has come from my weirdness. That like, you know, people were, I, you know, like take, for instance, For the Beaten. That's a guitar. Like, that's a fucking guitar part. Weep, 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 weep. You know, like, but that's a fucking guitar player. And like, because of his strangeness, like when I reached out to him, he was like, okay. And I was like, let me use that. Let me just put some other parts to that together. And let me just sing over the top of that. And like, there's a lot of that on this record. There's a lot of rule breaking and weirdness and heaviness, but it's ultimately the record's like heavy. You know what I mean? I'm still like, I'm not mellow. You know what I mean? Like, I haven't chilled, like, you know, always mellowed with age. No, there's none of that. Like I'm more aggressive. I just was working with the band Horror, you know, and like, you know, like they're fucking as aggressive as it gets.
Yeah.
And like, you know, they were listening to the song that I was playing them, and they were like, holy shit, this is heavy as hell. You know, and it is. I mean, I've blown subwoofers, you know, on some of the stuff that I'm doing because it's so low endy and crazy. And I to me, heavy is and exciting and music that like rips your head off is where I'm at. You know, like that's my default position.
Well, thanks for not mellowing with age.
Yeah, I mean, I mean
that was one of my thoughts. That was my thoughts. Yeah,
I can do mellow, and I like mellow, and that's what Take a Picture was all about. Like, it's beautiful. You know, it's a gorgeous, beautiful song. Like, I flex that muscle, but at the same time, I'm still Welcome to the Fold. You know what I mean? Like, I wrote Welcome to the Fold after Take a Picture. You know what I mean? Like I just wanted it to be heavy as hell. You know, something insane.
But even within the beauty of Take a Picture, the thematic and the meaning behind it is so, and what you were going through. That's what makes it even a heavy, like you said, you call it a heavy song from a content standpoint. It is.
It was a heavy, 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 like it was in the arguably like the hardest time of my life. Defeating being a raging alcoholic is so risky. Like, it is so crazy, the shit that I was doing, the nuttiness that I was living. Mm-hmm. And like the music represented what drugs and alcohol gave me. So the music was this lush bed of gorgeous music. And that was the sound of the drug. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But the lyrics are all about like how I'm drowning in this shit and I'm going to fucking die. You know, I'm not going to make it. Dad, what do you think about your son now? Help me. You know what I mean? Like the whole. All of that, that's what all of that stuff was about. Like, you know, I could you take my picture because I won't remember. Like, I literally said that to Darcy, like my girlfriend at the time. I was like, take my picture because I won't remember. And she's like, you should write that down. She's like, you should write that down. That's a good lyric. And I did. And I used it. Thank you. I appreciate it.
I cannot wait for the record, man. Thank you so much. And I'm looking forward to hearing it. I just can't wait.
It's the shit. It's the shit. All right, brother.
Can't wait. I can't wait.
Awesome.
Take care.
Thanks, man.